Well, I just saw Inside Out 2 this weekend, and it was 90 minutes, so.
Mel Gibson, he knew what the children wanted.
Clearly.
Famously. That was actually the other tagline. They went with, get ready to root for the bad guy. The other one was, Mel Gibson knows what the children want. So
that I'm glad creepy. They went with. Yeah. I thought it was Val Resnick.
Yeah.
That's a true fact. Welcome to 1999, the podcast. I'm John Brooks.
And I'm Julia Sermons.
Julia, you're still here.
I am. I've been keeping vigil ever since. Ever since John Leguizamo left Plato's Retreat in Summer of Sam.
Wah, wah. No, in all seriousness, the reason that you're still, you want to tell people the reason that you're, well, you're actually not here. Let's specify. First of all, you're in a bathroom in Spain. That's where you actually are.
Yes.
But where are you? Why are you still here?
I am here because I am going to be co-hosting this fine podcast.
That's how they say it in Spain. Podcast.
Yes.
Yes, that's very exciting. You are. So, welcome for your first official, co-pilot mission, I guess.
Thanks. Very excited to be here.
Your first Chewbacca run. Or something like that. I don't know. What's another co-pilot? Your first Iceman run. I don't know. I ran out of metaphors.
Chewbacca's probably more accurate.
Yeah. You're going to mostly be just grunting incoherently throughout the episode.
In terms of facial hair situation.
Yeah. Yes. People can't see that, obviously. Yeah. Anyhow, welcome. I'm glad you're carrying on the time-honored tradition of only having hosts whose name begin with J on this show. A thing that is now just going to have to live forever. Sorry, people whose name doesn't begin with J. You can't co-host this show. That's how it works. We got a fun one today. One that I'd kind of forgotten about in terms of a movie until our guest emailed me and was like, hey, this movie. And I was like, oh, right, that movie. So we're going to get to that as we talk a little bit about what movie we're talking about in today's episode. We're discussing the 26th highest grossing movie of 1999, sandwiched just above The Talented Mr. Ripley at 27th, a movie it beat out at the domestic box office by just a few thousand dollars. And Pokemon, the first movie, Mewtwo Strikes Back at 25th. We have not gotten to that one yet, the Pokemon first movie. Released February the 5th, going on to make $160 million worldwide on a budget of $90 million. Written and directed, sorta, by Brian Helgeland, based on the novel The Hunter by Donald E. Westlake under the name Richard Stark. And starring Mel Gibson, Maria Bello, Greg Henry, Lucy Liu, Deborah Kara Unger, David Paymer, who was everywhere in 1999, I recently discovered, Bill Duke, Jack Conley, one of my favorite character actors, John Glover, the great William Devane, James Coburn, and at least in one of the two versions we'll talk about today, the late, great, iconic, died this week, Chris Kristofferson. Today, we are talking about Payback.
I have Mr. Carter on the line.
Run through.
I have a problem.
There's a man in my office with a gun.
Who says that he's going to kill me if we don't pay him back
$130,000 that one of our lieutenants 70, stole 000. From him.
It's 70. Look.
How much is this guy Carter worth to you?
What do you mean?
My money, yes or no?
No.
Not many men know what their life's worth. I do. 70 grand. That's what they took from me.
Oh!
That's what I was gonna get back. They weren't wearing their seatbelts.
Who the hell are you?
I'm Porter.
He said his name was Porter.
Porter?
Porter?
Yeah. Real Cro-Magnon looking. You're not gonna kill me, are you?
Well, what's his first name?
I don't know.
You.
No, you don't. Allow me.
You look pretty good for a dead guy.
You were the only good thing in my life that hadn't been taken from me. I couldn't stay away.
You are one hell of a mosquito.
To get rid of you, I'll swat you with 130 grand.
It's not 100.
Hey! Perfect.
Yes, it's all right. He's just killing my alligator bags and shooting holes in my suit. Man, that's just mean. That's mean, man.
Where have you been?
Evening up the odds a little.
Hubba, 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 hubba.
Get ready.
Everything working out?
Oh, yeah. To root for the bad guy.
You are crazy. That's why I love you.
He's assigned your own death warrant for $130,000. What is it? The principal or something?
Stop it. I'm getting misty. And tell him it's 70, will you?
Mel Gibson.
What do you mean it's only 70? It's only 70,000? Hell, my suits are worth more than that.
Payback.
Careful, boy. He might bite you back.
So, Julia, what's Payback about?
Okay, flashback. Meet Mel Gibson's character, known only as Porter. He's getting two bullets pulled out of him in an operation where both the doctor and the surgical implements are soaked in whiskey. In a gruff voiceover, Porter says, "Not many men know what their life's worth. I do. 70 grand. And he's going to get that 70 grand paid back. Present day.
Oh, I get it.
Chicago. Present day, we're in Chicago, and Porter has no fucks to give. He's hopping turnstiles, he's stealing cigarettes from waitresses, he's buying suits with a stolen credit card. Porter visits his wife, who's struggling with heroin addiction. She overdoses and dies. In another flashback, we find out why Porter is looking for payback. He and a Weasley psychopath named Val Resnick stole $140,000 from a Chinese triad. Val needed the money to get in good with a shady criminal organization known as the Outfit, or maybe it's called the Syndicate. This is never totally clear. So Val convinced Porter's wife that Porter was having an affair. Val and the wife double-crossed Porter. They shot him, left him for dead, and took his share of the loot. Porter now wants it back, and he wants exactly $70,000. No more, no less. Porter eventually finds Val. Val has made nice with the outfit, and he's living it up with a bloodthirsty dominatrix named Pearl. The outfit tells Val to take care of Porter, and various hijinks ensue. Val rats Porter out to the triad, and they try to kill him. Porter is also getting chased down by Val's nebbishy friend Stegman and two crooked cops. Porter reconnects with Rosie, a sex worker he used to drive for. Val tries to get at Porter by beating up Rosie, but Porter comes in and kills Val, but not before getting the names of his bosses, Fairfax and Carter. For inexplicable reasons, the outfit refuses to just cut their losses and pay Porter his measly 70K. Using Rosie as bait, Porter kidnaps the son of the outfit's head honcho, Bronson. The triad comes after Porter, but he manages to literally outshoot them. The outfit catches Porter and starts to torture him, but he tricks them and then blows them all up. Rosie and Porter escape to Canada, where they maybe stop their lives of crime, but maybe they don't.
Payback was something of a surprise and largely forgotten minor hit, mostly riding on the coattails of Mel Gibson at the height of his popularity and box office appeal, having come off a string of hits including 1994's Maverick, 1995's Oscar-winning Braveheart, 1996's Ransom, and 1997's Conspiracy Theory, as well as the prestige of Brian Helgeland having come off an avalanche of award wins, including the Oscar for writing L.A. Confidential, as well as the aforementioned Conspiracy Theory. We'll forget Kevin Costner's 1997 film The Postman, which he also wrote, ever even happened. But the production of Payback also opened a window to some of the personal and professional issues surrounding Gibson that would become increasingly apparent in the years leading up to his career crash in the mid-2000s. Unhappy with the direction of the film Helgeland wrote and directed, Gibson had Helgeland fired and reworked and reshot much of the movie. Adding Kristofferson's character to the story and changing much of the tone and arc of the main character, Porter. The theatrically released version split critics, holding a 56% score on Rotten Tomatoes, a 46% on Metacritic. Mike LaSalle of San Francisco Chronicle gave it a glowing review, writing, quote, Payback has a completely different spirit from LA Confidential. More wild, more silly, but it is the same attention to the fine points of plot and character. More measured is Roger Ebert, who gave the film 3 stars and wrote, quote, not many people know what their life's worth. The hero of Payback tells us at the beginning, I do, 70 grand, and that's what they took from me, and that's what I'm going to get back. If you absorb that statement and take a close look at the title, you'll have a good idea of what the movie's about. The only remaining question, is it about it entertainingly? Yes. Ebert would also note that the movie lives or dies on the performance of Mel Gibson, but some critics were outright brutal, like Stephen Holden in the New York Times, who concludes, quote, Gibson, affecting his best macho growl, is at least able to keep a straight face through the tortured purple prose his character, who narrates the movie, is forced to deliver. What it lacks in originality, Payback tries to make up for in sadistic gore. Before they begin shooting and slicing one another, the characters take cackling relish in describing the tortures they would like to inflict. Amid the countless beatings that are administered, one kick in the groin won't do. There have to be at least 3 per scene. What one word might best describe Payback? How about loathsome? Close quote. That said, reviews for the director's cut, officially titled Payback Straight Up, which Helgeland put together and released on Blu-ray in 2006 with Gibson's blessing, are generally much more favorable, with many pointing out that, ironically, audiences were much more prepared to accept Gibson as a fundamentally irredeemable asshole now than when they were in 1999, when Helgeland's initial vision tested so poorly with screening audiences. So in essence, we have, in fact, 2 movies to talk about today. We will be talking about the theatrical cut of Payback and also our thoughts on the director's cut of Payback, which we both watched and which our guest has also seen and has his own opinions about. And our guest today is, again, by his own request, the world's biggest Payback fan, among other things, Jim Woods. Jim, welcome to the podcast.
Thanks so much for having me.
So aside from loving Payback, what else should people know about you off the top?
Off the top, I'm actually a writer as well, and I help other people write books. I'm an editor. I love fiction, and if you take Payback out of the equation, I mean, this movie to me is as influential as like Die Hard was to all the many, many, many Die Hard spinoffs. And I cannot remember much before I watched Payback. It was that big of a movie for me.
I guess you're not. Your life watching Payback.
I mean, it's definitely in my top 3. Definitely wow. In my top 3. Wow. Easily. I mean, it was nice to see a quote unquote bad guy anti-hero kind of front and center. I think I really enjoyed that because this is, you know, years and years before Breaking Bad or The Sopranos, and I always like wanted to see more of a I think that hook, you know, get ready to root for the bad guy. I think it was like, oh, this is just like, this is itching a scratch that I, or scratching an itch I've just been having. Mm-hmm. And I, when I saw this, I was like, this is, and also it's so lean and mean. It's 90 minutes flat. No, there's no filler in either version of Payback. And it's just like, you know, nowadays you watch movies and they're like 2.5-3 hours. And I look at it and I'm like, this freaking thing could have been 1.5 hours and it would have been better. So Payback, it checks all the boxes for me, and hugely influential for me, even as a writer.
So how old were you in 1999? What was your sort of like your media diet at the time?
I didn't see this in 99. I did not see it in the theater. I was literally a freshman in college. So I'm like 18, 19.
Yeah, we're the same age then. Yeah.
And I looked it up and it's like this movie didn't come out on video until like a year later. So we're talking literally like Y2K time, January of 2000.
Yeah.
It was almost a whole year. I mean, it's hard to believe now. It's like a whole year from, you know, movie to video. But Yeah, I remember it was like a blue VHS tape. None of them were blue. You'd have thought they were in cahoots with Blockbuster at the time to make a blue VHS tape just for Payback. And
wait, the actual like plastic of the tape was blue? Like it was an actual blue tape?
Totally blue. And it's like, and now with you talk about the blue hue on the film that they kind of washed it in. It's like, huh, that's interesting, right? But I remember I watched it and I was like, oh crap, I want to watch that again. Because it was just such a different kind of movie. It was so anti, you know, like Lethal Weapon with Riggs and Murtaugh. Right. It was like, ooh, he's got some edge here now. I kind of like this version of Mel versus, you know, literally, like I always kind of pictured him more as Riggs, like the crazy unstable cop, but still very much the good guy. So, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. I was wondering if we could talk about that a little more, actually. Was that like because we now know Mel Gibson as a colossal racist and director of Passion of the Christ? So like maybe we could talk more about like who was Mel Gibson as a movie star and like what was his persona and how is this movie playing into that, or as you just suggested, playing against it a bit.
Well, I mean, do we really know any of these people truly? I would throw that question at you. We do know he has a lot of substance abuse problems.
Yeah.
Mel. And that's where I'm kind of like, look, if someone's in recovery, you know, I don't want to judge harshly on somebody that, you know, I'm not saying any of the stuff he's done is okay either, not condoning, but what's he really like when he's sober would be my real question too. So, but he was kind of known as the nice guy, funny guy, jokester. Yep. And I think a lot, I remember Julia Roberts' conspiracy theory, because that actually plays a lot into Payback, and Dick Donner as the director for that. It's like he was just like notorious for being such a jokester, like extreme, like not quite Jared Leto Joker kind of off the wall insane jokester, but like pretty crazy, do anything for a laugh. And like I didn't know that much about it. I mean, again, this is like the 90s. I'm younger. I'm not watching all the behind the scenes stuff on Mel Gibson. It's just, it's funny how he's pretty lighthearted. I mean, he's usually just a kind of a silly guy, likable guy. I know a lot of folks say he's really, really attractive. I was like, man, this guy's in some pretty awesome movies. That was my whole take on it. I wasn't really like analyzing it then.
Yeah, I think he was the like kind of affable comedic action guy.
Yep.
Which is kind of why I think this movie is sort of interesting spin on that persona.
I mean, I think it was Riggs, but like in my mind, it's like you take Martin Riggs, what happens if he's not a cop? And I could see it spinning toward Payback. You know, I really could. It's like if he's not a cop and like Porter even has a little Marine tattoo on his arm. And I know in Lethal Weapon, it's like, I feel like almost this could be like, okay, this is the what if story. If Martin Riggs never commits suicide and he goes off and just becomes a bad guy, I could see it's not that far off. He's just a little less of a silly jokester watching the Three Stooges. Instead of that, he's just a little more quiet and a little less, you know, talky and kind of zany. That's how I view it, honestly. But, you know, I'd love to hear your guys' thoughts for sure.
Yeah, I mean, like, I remember, so I was a big fan of Gibson in the 90s, kind of before Passion of the Christ and before some of the darker stuff about him became obvious. And I remember exactly, you know, reading the very same articles about what he was like on the set of Conspiracy Theory, the Julia Roberts talking about all the pranks he would pull and everything else, and just sort of like, you know, that's who Mel Gibson was, this like, you know, affable kind of weird dude from Australia, sort of with a dad we don't talk about. Right. And like, it's a whole different ball of wax, But the thing that was so compelling about Gibson is that he has this, and you can see it in this movie at times too, he has this ability with his eyes to be incredibly sort of gentle and vulnerable. And all of it is sort of also kind of masking the simmering rage. I mean, I'm not a fan of Braveheart by any means, but like, you know, you see a lot of that in Braveheart, right? It is sort of this combination of like, you know, golden-hearted optimism with like unbridled rage that he is able to sort of contain at the same time. And, you know, you also then like contrast that with this other side of Gibson, which is like the what women want side of it, where he plays this kind of almost Hollywood classic, right, kind of leading man, almost a like a Clark Gable, right, type in that movie. And his ability, like I think he's a obviously deeply complex and obviously, you know, tormented in a lot of ways person. But he was always very generous with that complexity on the screen. And, you know, that's what to me, like, made it such a bummer when sort of a lot of, you know, a lot of the stuff came to a head. And having that, like, art versus the artist moment for me with him really sucked. So I kind of, I mean, like, I knew, and one of the reasons why I like the director's cut better is that I kind of knew that this side of Mel Gibson was like there, and that's something like very purely him, really, about this like simmering, you know, vengeful rage that is much more interesting sort of in the future, looking back now. But yeah, I mean, he was, I really think, like one of the most interesting and compelling actors of his generation. Yeah, this is a really interesting film to watch, like, again, from the future, in looking back of what we know now.
Yeah, I mean, I think for me, so much is going on with this film tonally. I think partially because it was a film that was reshot, but then also I think because he's trying to have his, like, play up this, like, Clint Eastwood, you know, kind of heartless, tough guy persona that he's experimenting with, which I don't, you know, I think works fine for good stretches of the movie, but he does have these really, he has these really lovely moments sort of, you know, where his just like, you'll just see his face fall or that vulnerability cracks through. I think like particularly when you see him, see his wife again for the first time and he sees that she's, you know, kind of fallen into addiction, that like he's watching her from afar, that I think are just, you know, that like kind of tenderness and vulnerability that you talk about there are just, you know, are just kind of wonderfully served in those moments that are a little bit too fleeting, maybe.
You know, I would push back on that just to say you put too much tenderness in there. It doesn't fit tonally. Yeah. And I would say it's in the genre. And I'm not saying don't have those emotional moments. Absolutely critical. Otherwise, you're watching a robot. So I'm totally with you on having it in there. I guess maybe timing is a huge element in the mix. Also, too, what you and I, like, we all can watch the same movie. And some parts we'd be like, this part dragged. This was a little long. Some of us might catch one moment and be like, wow, it was incredible. And it stood out to me. It's just so relative. And I honestly, too, are we talking about the theatrical cut or right. the director's cut? Because,
yeah.
I mean, Rosie is not even in the director's cut very much at all. And I'm like, I always kind of like the relationship of Rosie and Porter. And that's focused a lot more on the theatrical cut. And that's like one reason why I think I like the dynamic of the two. And Porter's a hell of a lot nicer to Rosie in the theatrical cut than he is in the director's cut. So it's kind of like, well, which one are we talking about? It becomes the question as well. So it's really like two sides of one coin, which, you know, do you like the heads or the tails? And they're both, there's so much similar in each movie, but yet there's also a lot different in how it hits the viewer, I think.
Yeah. So let's talk about the two cuts a little bit. I definitely am on the side of the director's cut. I vastly preferred it. I know that you are on the other side of that coin, that you prefer the theatrical cut. So explain why. Like, what do you think? Or do you think there are things in the director's cut that are better, or do you just think?
Oh,
like,
yeah. No. I love both. I love the theatrical cut more, and I wouldn't enjoy the director's cut without the theatrical cut kind of being the foundation.
That's an interest. I was trying to have that.
Does that make sense?
Like, I was trying to play that counterfactual in my head. I was trying to think of like, what if one of these was the only one that existed? It's really hard to do that when you just watch them back to back. But
I think, and I just watched the theatrical, the director's cut last night. I watched the whole thing, and I really like just let it wash over me. I haven't watched the theatrical one in a few weeks, but just the opening of the director's cut. It's muffled. It's muddled. It's not grabbing the viewer as much as seeing Porter on that operation table. And to me, the opening, that was huge. You weren't expecting to see Mel all bloody and half conscious and this alcoholic doctor working on him, very likely in a shady clinic and all that. And it's like right there out of the gate, the hook is in. Then you see him. And guess what? After he gets up from that table, it's nonstop movement for the whole freaking movie. Yeah. So that right there, it's like he's literally flat on his back dying. And then it doesn't stop moving from that point on. And also there's more humor in the theatrical cut. The voiceover makes the character more realistic, less stoic, less Clint Eastwood. Ish, if you will. Mm-hmm. There's more explosions, frankly. I kind of like that. That iconic cigarette drop.
Yeah.
That was amazing. I'm not saying it's realistic. We're not talking about realism. We're talking about fiction.
You can't do that. You can't blow a car up that way.
I watched the Mythbusters on it. Definitely not. But
bummer.
I think that the ending being more hopeful, more upbeat, it's a little cheesy. I'm not denying this, but having an ending that's a little more hopeful versus completely ambiguous, it leaves you walking away from the movie like, hey, this the quote unquote bad guy won. But again, he was the better of all the other bad guys.
They're all bad guys, right? It's a whole world just of nothing but bad guys.
Exactly.
So there's no like pure-hearted good person to root for here, except for maybe Rosie. But even she is like, it's
right. And I think but again, back to the color, I think it did help because too bright is my real impression of the director's cut. It's just a little too bright, a little too distracting by color. It looks too modern. It looks too Chicago versus it could be any city in the blue cut. In my mind. I mean, it's just a little more,
Yeah. Well, it looks a lot like New York at various times, right? In the blue. Blue, in the
exactly.
Blue
so. Exactly. So that's why I prefer the original. Not saying there's not amazing stuff in the director's cut.
Sure. Julia, what's your verdict?
I also prefer the director's cut by a country mile, I'd say. But I think we kind of just had very kind of opposite reactions to like the color for me. And I want to come back to the question of noir and film noir, because I think that's like a hugely interesting question for both director's cut and regular cut. But for me, the color with the bleach bypassing on the original version, it just looks so cheap to me and so kind of like washed out. And I think like it's kind of going for film noir, but it just kind of doesn't have the richness of those blacks and those whites. And it doesn't, yeah. It just all kind of looks a little bit flat. Whereas when you see the color in the original, in the director's cut, that was how it was shot. That was how it was meant to be shown. And you can just tell like it, everything looks better. Like maybe also this is where we differ on Gibson's acting. But like he is a better actor, I think, with the lighting and the color. I think you know the framing and the shots just look more of a piece and look more intentional. And I think what it comes down to, I think, really for me is that the color cinematography has like a neo-noir feel to it without being quite so literal. And I think the original cut is trying to be a noir in ways that are too literal as opposed to being kind of just suggestive of noir. And that makes it a more coherent movie in the director's cut.
Yeah, I completely agree. I think, and like Jim, I think you make some really interesting points about the theatrical cut, which I take to heart. But the thing about the color grading in the theatrical cut is that it really feels like, I know they're going for this really cool, like it's black and white, but it's not black and white, right? Like noir thing. And I appreciate the sort of effort. I think it's sometimes really works and has a really cool effect of being both black and white and not black and white at the same time. I did see like a thing about Mel Gibson being like, it needs to be more black and white. I'm like, well, just make a fucking black and white movie then. Like, what are you doing? Just Mel, make it black and white. It's not hard, right? Like you can actually just do that. But to me, like the thing that I just kept thinking of, and I think I talked about this when we talked about Stigmata like a year or so ago, is that it comes across as an aesthetic that I call Matchbox 20 aesthetic, where there was like every music video of a certain genre of this age kind of like looked like that. And it's this, you know, it's this incredibly like low saturation, high contrast kind of look. And sometimes it worked. And sometimes I was like, I'm watching a Matchbox 20 video, right? Whereas what I liked about the director's cut is that I think it achieves the mood of noir without kind of forcing its hand. And it just sort of felt like the weird washed out look of the theatrical cut just kind of felt a little too forced. And I loved actually the look of the director's cut so much more. One of the things that I think is more effective about the theatrical cut and sort of the way that it's done is that I like that the movie exists in a kind of a never time, right? It's sort of like, it reminds me of like Batman the Animated Series, which is a weird thing to say, but like it exists in a time where like there's rotary phones everywhere for whatever reason, right? But like it has all this sort of like film noir quality to the world, but like it's also clearly modern. It is sort of like it's cool. Like I like that about it a lot, and that felt more effective in the theatrical cut. But what I love about the director's cut is that I was saying to Julie, I'm like, this is basically just The Crow. Like it's a guy who like gets fucked over, gets resurrected, and then like murders the fuck out of everybody and then dies. Like, you know, once
isn't that all revenge movies though? I mean, right? That's the genre. You can't argue against the genre.
No, it is.
That's like saying I don't like a Western because it's a Western. That's kind of a...
No, I love it. I love that it's The Crow. But like, I was just like, this is the same fucking plot as The Crow, but like including this sort of ambiguous ending where you're not really quite sure what's going to happen to him at the very end of the movie. But like, you know, he's basically brought back to life in mysterious circumstances, goes on a revenge tour, and then maybe dies at the end of it. And I liked the consistency of him just like being in it for himself, like a vengeance driven bad dude who like is just killing the fuck out of other bad dudes, and like he's the one who just happens to win because they all are just terrible. And the lack of complexity I actually really liked about the director's cut, like for that reason.
That makes a lot of sense. I think that the fact that Porter is more of a nice guy, I'm not saying he's a good guy, but more gentle human. I think that's what I really am more drawn to with the original theatrical cut. And even the gray, my brain pulls it in like, this guy is conflicted. Like, what if this guy, maybe there's a glimmer of hope that he and Rosie aren't shady forevermore in my mind. I'm not saying that's what the movie's setting up, but in my mind, when it processes, I'm like, are they out still, you know, shooting people and hooking? I don't go that direction in my mind, but I could see where, you know, 99% of the population probably was like, oh yeah, they're in jail or they're dead or whatever. I see a glimmer of hope where it probably isn't with the nicer, more gentle anti-hero. And I think like you mentioned the Batman animated series, because I'm like, this guy, he's not extremely far off from Batman in my mind, because he's just on his own revenge spree, and instead of a Batmobile all his goodies, I'm like, he's walking around on foot, you know. I mean, I don't see that
all the
much
guys
difference.
He's going after are very like rogues gallery as well, right? Like David Paymer's character, like they're very sort of like over the top kind of caricatures of, you know, the kind of mobster bad guys, which I thought was kind of fun.
Exactly.
Yeah. Which is also like a film noir thing too, right?
Absolutely.
The, like, kind of like colorful psychopaths and shucksters and, you know,
weirdos
who populate the underworld. Can we talk more about that though? Can we talk about the characters we liked and the performances we liked?
Julia, why don't you start?
A lot of great work here, but most of my love has to go to James Coburn as which one is he? Fairfax or Carter?
Fairfax, yeah.
Fairfax. Yeah. He just like, and this was, he was coming off of Affliction, right, and his Oscar win and this huge career renaissance for him. And he just like, he knows what kind of movie this is. He's like, this is a weirdo, hard-boiled movie, and my job is to be the weirdo gangster with the flashy wardrobe and to come in there and just act kind of like vaguely perturbed that I've been called back from my turtle swimming vacation to deal with this lunatic. And just everything about him, he seems so realized, so fully realized the character. And then when Gibson shoots up his, you know, crocodile suit briefcases and goes, that's just mean, man. Like that line delivery, it just gets me every time. Oh my God.
Easily one of the best quotes from the whole movie, right?
It's just mean.
Yeah. Yeah.
Well, yeah, when Coburn says, who the hell are you? Such a great moment. Oh, man. And he was dead 3 years after this. I think, like, Monsters, Inc. was one of the last things he did. He died in 2002. So, yeah, he's you know, this is one of his last performances. But, no, fully agree. The question of, you know, Kristofferson, because one version of the movie has Chris Kristofferson and the other does not, right?
Yep.
I liked the kind of simplification of a hierarchy that ends kind of with him in the theatrical cut. But in the director's cut, I like the idea that they're just kind of everywhere. And that it's like, by the end of the movie, there's just like everybody he meets is one of them. And they're all like that lady on the train at the end, right? You know, like there's this idea that there's this just massive network of people. And he has to kind of like kill everybody who he encounters because they're all out to get him. So certainly that was like one of the major kind of narrative choices, differences. But like, I don't know, is Chris Kristofferson good enough an addition to the movie to sort of make it worth having him? Because he's the kind of person who I could watch like read the phone book, right? I mean, he's just magnetic in so many ways. But like, that's basically what he's doing in this movie. He's kind of reading the phone book. You know what I mean? Like, there's not a lot to it.
The phone book included saying, I'll make you find out what your left ball tastes like.
Oh, Jesus. Yes.
That See, I thought that book. Line was great because it's intimidating coming from him. I mean, like, I believe him with that scowl on his face. I believed him as the boss, and that you got to have the boss. And I think that's why, like, having just a woman's voice on the phone, that's lazy writing. I'm sorry. That's a cop out. It really is. And then you have how many people at the subway station that are all in the mob or the outfit or the syndicate or whatever you want to call it. Right. Having the hierarchy falls in line with mob rules to an extent.
Yeah. Yeah.
I like Kristofferson. I really do. I would question the whole kidnapping Johnny part. That's one part I would question. And I know that's
a lot. It's just, it's a stretch. I don't get
it's
it.
It's a definite stretch. Yeah.
You
know, that was tacked on. So again, you know, either it's a woman's voice on the phone or the kidnapping at the boxing event. You know, you can't hit home runs all the time on that part.
Yeah.
But I think Greg Henry is my favorite.
I agree.
Talk about chewing up scenery. I mean, I haven't seen many actors pull off what he does. He brings all the, like, you hate him. You hate him so much. Mm-hmm. And he's so obnoxious, you know, cursing and screaming at the diner with all these families looking around ready to, like, get into fights over nothing. And, even just beating the snot out of one of the Chinese gangsters that they crashed into. He's like beating the crap out of the guy for no reason other than he enjoys it. And you're like, this guy's really messed up and twisted. And so Porter taking him out is like really satisfying. And it's like, that's a huge moment in the whole movie where, what's next? Oh, we're moving up the chain here. You could possibly argue it's like, well, maybe Mal or Val died too early in the story.
I wondered that as well.
You know what I'm saying? Like Carter, that was a great scene, but it was more a little shocking than like a real threat, you know?
Yeah.
And Fairfax, I mean, I agree. Funny, hilarious, but was he a real threat? Maybe another threat in the mix would have even made this even better.
Yeah, Greg Henry, he's cheerful, he's angry, and he'll kill you on a dime.
Yep.
And he's also very stupid.
Right.
And he plays all those notes perfectly.
He does.
And there's just these like little bits of business he does with his like mouth twitching and you know, just the little grace notes he puts on there. It's a great performance.
Even the little thing, like him eating chow mein noodles and going, "Hi, sweetie," to the little girl going by, you're like, and you're cringing. And he's just, it's almost like he makes me like Porter that much more, because Porter's not beating people up for entertainment and jollies and, you know, not with a dominatrix Lucy.
Yeah, or having Lucy Liu beat him up. Right.
Right.
Right. Right.
And,
right. Yeah.
And he even kind of rejects Pearl, which, I mean, let's be honest, a lot of movies that probably wouldn't have been rejecting Pearl. I don't think. I mean, it's like there could have been something goofy there. And I'm like, no, he doesn't care. He's on his mission. You know, he's doing what he has to do, get his money back.
Well, in terms of the cast and the actors on display here, I think that the point that you made at the beginning, that both cuts are an hour and a half, but they're very like, you know, they get in, get out and don't make a fuss and just sort of get to the point. And I agree with that. I still think the theatrical cut, because of the fact that it was rewritten on the fly and everything else, I think it has some pacing issues that the director's cut doesn't have. Like, I actually think the director's cut is better paced. But also, having said that, there are no bad performances in this movie. They're all great, right? And like, you have just this really wonderful menagerie of like really great character actors in people like David Paymer and you know, John Glover and William Devane and Bill Duke, and like, it's awesome. There's just so many of them. The one thing that I would say, I kind of felt, oh man, you have all these great actors, like give me another 15 minutes of this movie so you can just like just get a little bit more of the performances out of them. Mm-hmm. Because Devane's scenes are great, but there's like two of them and he's perfect. Like it's him doing his thing and he's perfect. But like, I would love more William Devane than I get in this movie. Right. And like, that's the only downside of it being only an hour and a half, is that you have these fantastic actors chewing scenery, but you just don't get enough of it, which is a shame.
Yeah, and I think that goes to your earlier point about Kristofferson, because I had the same feeling as you did, versus like, oh, we just lost him, and I'm just kind of like, meh on this whole this whole part, and like. I mean, like, I think part of it was just like he was added in at the last minute. It was tacked on. He just wasn't really given that much interesting to do. But yeah, John Glover, the big winner in the reshoots.
Yeah.
He gets a much larger part. So yeah. At least John Glover's agent was happy.
Sure.
I also have to say, like, I'm a big proponent of the fact that Maria Bello was always a very underused and underrated actor. I think there is a sort of like broadly appealing prettiness to her that I think always kind of was to her detriment. Helgeland was desperate to get her in this movie. He basically stalked her for 2 weeks until she agreed to be in it. Nice. Not literally stalked her, but like, she was like, no, I don't really do that kind of thing. And he's calling her like every day being like, I really, really like, this is like, I really want you for this role. And thank God he did, cause she is really perfect for it. Like, she fits the bill entirely. But I think she is a really terrific actor, and was just one of those people that, like, you know, she never really quite worked as like someone who could carry a whole movie as like a leading lady. Mm-hmm. And she's kind of like too pretty to be like a character actor in Hollywood. So she's had a good career and she's done good work, but there's something about, I think, just, I don't know what it is, but there's something about sort of, you know, her, for whatever reason, casting directors just never saw what Brian Helgeland saw, and it's unfortunate because she's really good in this movie, like really, really in both versions, she's very good.
Have you guys ever done the audio commentary from Helgeland on the, like, when he talks about why he quote unquote got fired? Basically, he refused to change the cut. It's an interesting behind the scenes look, and basically, because he wrote Conspiracy Theory, he was buddies, and his mentor was really Dick Donner, Richard Donner, from all of our Lethal Weapon, right?
Right.
So he got to know Dick Donner, and of course, he's super tight with Mel. And it was really just a big favor of Gibson to even be in the movie. Mm-hmm. And Dick Donner just kind of kept pushing him, mentoring him. I mean, frankly, it was a miracle this movie ever was made, period. Mm-hmm. It was favors. It was a very tight shoot in Chicago. It was, you know, most movies, it's like, whoa, the behind the scenes is even more incredible than the movie itself. You know, Apocalypse Now, for example, it's like, how did this ever get made? But Dick Donner was a huge influence. And then Helgeland, he was like, okay, straight up 70s noir, here we go, gritty all the way. And it came down to like a couple scenes, and Brian even jokes about it. He's like, one, I killed the dog. You'd never ever want to kill the dog. That was what basically got me fired. And the other was Maria Bello getting killed, or Maria Bello essentially having Porter kill the one guy in the supply truck at the end of the director's cut. And he's like, between Porter killing this innocent guy at the end, quote unquote innocent, because he hooked up with Maria Bello's character, like, that was it. It was those two things. And he's like, I'm not changing these two things. So Brian kind of walked off. It was like, it really was interesting. And he was like laughing about it. And the fact that we're even holding the straight up version is amazing, because it was like 6 years after the fact, 7 years right. after the fact.
Right. Yep. Yeah.
And it was like, it was a labor of love on both movies, really. It wasn't, hey, we're going to make this big money movie. It was more like, hey, it's a big favor. Let's get this Brian to get his feet wet. Cause it was his first directorial debut, really.
Yeah.
And it's really interesting. Like, it sounded like he learned a ton in the process, and he's like, you know what? I stuck to my guns. It served me well. Cause he's a screenwriter more than a director.
Yeah. I always got the impression that this was not, I mean, I knew that, you know, he and Gibson had talked about him releasing his cut, and that was that. I mean, a lot of it had to do with like test screenings, and they just like, mm-hmm. again, audiences did not like the idea of a purely like bad Mel Gibson, right? At this time, it just wasn't selling. Right. So I understand that it's one of those, there's been situations in the past where a director has been fired from his own movie, and like, it is not, you know, all under you know, water under the bridge kind of thing, right?
Right.
And that this kind of is one such instance, which I'm very grateful for, because again, I like having both of these movies to kind of contrast with each other. For sure. I do, like, there is a academic paper to be written, and people have written about it before, for sure, but Mel Gibson's preoccupation with torture. And as soon as they get to, like, oh, of course we got to get to a scene where Mel Gibson is, like, horrifically tortured, because if there's one consistent thing that, like, Mel Gibson loves to throw in his movies, it's, like, him or Jesus getting horrifically tortured.
I don't know if that's fair, John. It's not like Tom Cruise running. Don't even pretend. I mean, how many movies are you talking here, really?
So
he wasn't tortured in that many of the Lethal Weapons. The first
No. But like, so people have like pointed to like the Braveheart torture scene and the scene in this movie, and the way that like the Passion of the Christ is just 2 hours of Jesus being tortured.
He wasn't like, in the Passion of the Christ.
I know, but he directed it. I know. He did it to Jim Caviezel. I understand. But I did kind of roll my eyes, because there is something about Mel Gibson where he does love that like brutal, visceral, you know, sort of like, I don't know, machismo of the guy, you know, getting.
Yeah.
I mean, compared to Jack Bauer, it's nothing, obviously, but you know, but
there you go.
A couple years later. No, I'm just sort of I'm kind of having a laugh at Mel Gibson's expense, but Julia, what are your thoughts on the success of both or either of these cuts, like as film noir and as a kind of revival or homage to the film noir style?
Yeah, so I think it's got the fundamental story and film footage and stuff has, you know, film noir influences and a film noir look to it that, you know, carries over to both versions. Like there's these, they're really beautiful shot compositions. Like when Porter is shot and he falls to the ground and you see him in close up and the deep background of them driving away, lots of use of like grates and light and shadow and stuff that are these very film noir compositions. And so I think you get that in both of them. I think like because of the voiceover makes it more noirish. The kind of hard boiled style makes the original more noirish in that aspect. I kind of felt with that, it felt kind of to me like they were sort of trying to tack a noir feeling and look onto a Mel Gibson action movie, essentially. Like that they kind of wanted to make Mel Gibson a noir hero, but noir heroes are kind of too much of sad sacks, right? and like nobody wants to see Mel Gibson being a sad sack, so they kind of made it more action hero-y. And I felt like the seams show a little bit more in that sense on the two sides. But as we said, like him just being this kind of like man completely consumed by vengeance, and you know, like without much compunction that we see in the director's cut, that's also very noir. And I think the kind of like the kind of fatalistic ending that we get where like he's probably gonna die, right? But you just see this like pure look of satisfaction on his face as he drives away, because like he got it. He was on a quest. He was on a totally perverse quest, and he got that goddamn money. You know, that to me is extremely noir. And like I said before, I do feel like the cinematography in the original color is very neo-noir. It has something in common with like some of the Michael Mann stuff and with Body Heat and stuff like that, which is, and it's like assimilating noir and quoting noir without being so literal about it in a way that I think makes the whole thing cohere a little bit more.
Well, a couple points on that, because you made me remember something that I did specifically like prefer about the director's cut that I can point to. It's funny you mentioned Mann, because actually the like washed out version of the theatrical cut like looks a lot more like The Insider, which we'll get to at some point in the near future. So one of the times where I was like, oh, I really like the coloring in this version better, when I really first realized that I kind of missed something, or like it didn't register in the same way, is when Val puts his cigarette out in Porter's blood, which when the blood is like that very rich red that Helgeland gives it, right, it's just much more effective as a moment, as opposed to like this sort of pool of dewiness dark something, right? That we get in the theatrical version. But the other thing that I think is monumentally better for me about the director's cut is the score, because Scott Stambler's score for the Helgeland cut is so much more understated. It's much less intrusive. It really kind of drives the narrative much more. Whereas I feel like the score that was written for the theatrical cut, again, much like the voiceover, is trying to like push the noir side like a little too much, and it kind of gets in the way, I think, of some of the pacing. I really realized, it didn't occur to me until I watched the director's cut, that I was like, oh, one of the things that bugged me about the theatrical cut is that the score is too invasive and too kind of noir forced. But anyway, that's my take on that.
That like jazzy jazz music as he's like strolling through Chicago.
Yeah.
it's quite heavy.
It's too jazzy jazz. It really is. It is too jazzy jazz. Jim, you were showing us a couple of the various iterations you have of the book.
Yeah, I've got a few versions of the original source material here. Richard Stark's The Hunter, which is just briefly mentioned at the beginning of the movie. And it really is very, very similar to the director's cut. But there are some important changes. And half of this book, like literally, is from Val Resnick's point of view. And I always found that really interesting, where it's like, okay, we have Parker or Porter for like the majority of the book, but a good percentage of it, you're kind of seeing Mal's character, Val, sorry, interchangeable here because same guy, like him, what do I do? How do I get in fit again with the outfit and the syndicate? How do I kind of fit back in? And then there really are a few different changes. Like, this is a series. I think Donald Westlake wrote like 50 of these books, and the real big bads are not, like, there is no Bronson in this original book. And the ending has some similarities, but there's also some differences. But just the whole tone of basically Porter being like abusive. It's in this book. And it's like, if without theatrical cut, like in my brain as I'm reading, I probably get a little more turned away from this. I kind of shrug it off a little bit because I'm like, that's one interpretation. I'm going to take it as, you know, my wife shoots me, it's okay to bump her with the door kind of thing is my perspective. But like, you know, the director's cut, I heard Deborah Unger broke a rib. Like she got tossed in the freaking oven and she broke a rib and she was like chuckling about it. She's like, I got a little carried away and I kind of broke a rib. And I'm like, man, I wish she kind of actually had more screen time other than, you know, showing up and not really getting to do that much. But yeah, the source material, and they even made a graphic novel based on The Hunter. And of course, it's like all gray, like everything is gray and black. And I just thought that was kind of funny, cool. Where it's like they doubled down on this grayish, bluish tint. And it's actually a really good story. It's just, you know, you have to kind of ignore some parts, at least I do. And I think I've seen the reviews on it. People are like, this guy, there's nothing to like about him. But with Porter's voiceover, it sticks in my head a little more. And it's like, oh, he's funny. He's sarcastic. He's witty. I view him as redeemable to some extent. But you're picking this up straight up. You're just like, why is the main character a total piece of crap, you know? And you're like, oh, this guy's beating everyone up and abusive and so it's interesting how it's like there's so many versions of the same character. And I mean, frankly, this character from Donald West, like, he's popped up in a lot of other movies, always under different names. It's not Parker, which is the character's name from the author Parker. He was in I think it's Point Blank with Robert Duvall as this same character Mel Gibson plays. And it's just, there's so many variations. It's kind of like almost there's so many different Batman movies. It's like, well, which version are you talking about here?
Yeah. Do we know what, I mean, this is sort of not that important, but do we know why the character was changed from Parker to Porter?
I believe that was at the request of the author.
Okay.
I believe, it might have just been a stylistic thing. You know, it's just such a tiny little tweak.
No, it's interesting because John Borman directed, it's not Robert Duvall, it's Lee Marvin.
Lee Marvin, okay, sorry. There is a Robert Duvall, The Outfit. That's the sequel.
Gotcha. And his character gets changed to Walker in Point Blank. So there obviously is this thing where, like, you have to change, I guess he's really attached to Parker as his character, which kind of makes sense. Have you seen Point Blank? I've never seen it. I'd like to now, like, do a compare and contrast at some point.
I saw it ages ago, but it's so dated of the time.
Okay.
And Lee Marvin is, I remember it now it's coming back to me. It's so stoic. You think Porter and Mel Gibson are stoic. It's like you're just watching a guy do his work, and it's not as it's not as Hollywoodized, frankly, because in the 90s we were, you know, about explosions with cigarettes, you know, that kind of thing. You know, I mean, even the theatrical cut now, it's like that whole setup of the bomb under the bed. I mean, they're going out with a bang on that story, you know, it's just such a different tone. It didn't feel like the same character to me, but
Lee Marvin, notoriously famous for playing stone cold psychopaths in noir movies.
But he didn't say the same at all. It didn't feel the same. I mean, plus the age, like Lee Marvin never really looked super, super young. In my opinion.
That's true. That's true. Yeah, he was kind of a guy who was perpetually old. I will admit, like, I did find the luring them into the apartment with the bomb in it moment very satisfying in the theatrical cut. It's pretty great.
And he tunnels his way out of a car trunk. It's incredible. It's amazing. Yeah. Like
24 was making notes. Hey, Jack Bauer can do this kind of cool stuff too.
Yeah.
You know, it was like using that tire iron. It's like right on that edge of believability. You know, using the tire iron to poke through the seat. I'm like, actually, that would work. Yeah. Yeah.
I do think, like, I kind of joked about it before, but I do think there is an element, like, you know, like how after he got his like fucking toes crushed with like a mallet, like how the fuck is he moving at all? Like it, you know, so like it beggars belief a little bit. But, you know, I made the Jack Bauer joke because I do think there is a line to be drawn here that this kind of like new millennium 1999 through post 9/11 time of like depictions of masculinity and this like weird revival of this like, you know, tortured Ubermensch character, right? Is like there definitely is a period of time where that kind of archetype reemerges, which happens to be sort of set against a period of time in recent American history that is very tumultuous and like very, you know, full of sort of social and cultural changes.
Right.
And I do find that interesting because like there is a lot of Jack Bauer here, right? Especially in the Gibson version of it, right? It is that kind of a thing where it's at towards the end, you're like, this isn't possible. Like you can't possibly be, you know, in a state of mind and not screaming in agony to like do the thing that you're doing right now. But that's kind of what makes it cool. Right. And sort of heightens it
with the mention of the feet. Like part of me wants to say, and it's like, this is kind of Die Hard meets a straight up revenge movie, in a sense, where you have a practical guy going around, especially at the beginning when it's like, okay, I'm getting my stuff together. And the book really breaks this down where it's like, okay, he goes here and he gets his suitcases and then he trades this here. And they show some of it in the movie where it's like, okay, then he gets his gun and he takes his watches to the pawn shop. And it's just, it's interesting to see. It's like, okay, I'm piecing my stuff together. I'm collecting all my inventory for what I need for this job. And then from that point on, it's like, okay, this guy has a problem. What's he going to do about all these bad guys?
Mm-hmm.
And just that whole, the foot thing made me think of like, well, that's kind of right there in Die Hard with the feet mm-hmm. getting bloody. Yeah. That's his moment, his lost moment. All is lost. He thinks he's going to die. They didn't really show it so much because it would make him too human in Payback mm-hmm. because this is a fantasy movie. It's not as realistic as Die Hard. There's no wife to be lost because his wife already died very early on in the movie from the overdose. And by the way, the wife is the real villain too, because she's the one that shot him.
It's true. It's true.
But it's just, it's funny how it's like different ideas, just changing the order up, little tweaks. But the foot thing, yeah, you're not walking. You're not able to move. You're likely crippled for life, but we keep moving anyway. And I think I like the tenacity.
Very philosophical.
It is. It's like you just keep moving anyway. Just like just crawling around
with mallets. We soldier on to get revenge on our enemies.
Yeah. Well, it's interesting that you like. It's an interesting pivot point, right? Between from the guy who's like, you know, in the 90s, like action heroes, but they were just like basically just guys to the like point now where like action heroes are just like completely indestructible and like completely ripped and just like roided out and like, you know, half of Manhattan can blow up and they're still standing.
Right. Yeah. And also, I mean, you know, Jim, you said very, very early on here, right, that you made the Sopranos reference. In fact, the Sopranos debuted a month before this movie came out, right? So like,
wow.
This is all sort of a piece. And of course, at the end of the movie, you get Fight Club and there's a lot of the same kind of ideas being entertained and explored in Fight Club as well, right, of destructibility being sort of the point and the ability to be like hurt and, you know, like banged up and still soldiering on. Like there is a lot of that sort of reemerging. And I think it's like it kind of came and went. We're back to Tom Cruise being able to do superhuman things in the Mission Impossible franchise, right, as like the default that we're going. And that's because of sort of where we are culturally, right? I think that's happening. But yeah, there is certainly the sort of appeal of the anti-hero and the appeal of the sort of, you know, pincushion of an action hero, right? Like
beating him up continually.
There is a good 10-year span where that is very clearly something for which people had an appetite.
I think looking back, because it's funny, this movie doesn't get talked about much at all. That's why I was so excited to talk with you about it. It's like, but as I talk to people about movies, a lot of people have seen it and a lot of people like it. It's just not like front of mind. And I think like conspiracy theory probably falls in there too. And Ransom, like those, they blurred together. All these Mel Gibson movies were like so close together. And also, I mean, like you guys mentioned too, all of his falling from grace, all his problems, all of his rehab issues and substance abuse issues, like we're not talking about his older stuff. And you mentioned Passion of the Christ. Yeah, that took a lot. Like nobody talks about Apocalypto. I haven't even seen it. I've heard it's amazing, and I will see it at some point, but like no one ever talks about it.
It's a cinematic achievement. It is very problematic in like a lot of different ways, but like it's a thing to behold. I will say that much. Like it is not a lazy half-assed movie. It is it's a whole ass thing, that is for sure. But yeah, I talk to me when you've seen Apocalypto. We can
I just from what I've heard, I'm such a crime guy. I'm kind of like that movie's gonna be exhausting. I know this because I saw The Patriot in theaters and I was like, I need a nap. And it was great and I loved it. But I those really long movies that are, you know, I love my payback because it's short and sweet. You know,
you like your 90-minute movies.
Yeah, 90 minutes is the perfect sweet spot. If we could only make more 90-minute movies, the world would be a happier place, I think. But that's me.
Well, I just saw Inside Out 2 this weekend and it was 90 minutes. So there you go.
Mel Gibson, he knew what the children wanted.
Clearly.
Famously.
Or Brian or the other director.
That was actually the other tagline. They went with, you're going to get ready to root for the bad guy. The other one that was being floated as an option was, Mel Gibson knows what the children want. So
I'm glad creepy. They went with. I thought it was Val Resnick.
Yeah.
That's a true fact. I didn't just make that up. That's a real thing that happened. Yeah. we should start wrapping up pretty soon. Any other thoughts on this movie from either of you that you think we need to get to before we do so?
It's one of those movies. I mean, yeah, if I wanted to really, 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 really nitpick at it, you can pick at it for sure. I mean, every movie, but I think the constant moving is what I love the most. And I see it repeated again later with like Kill Bill 1, where it's like constant movement. I'm traveling here. And it's almost, I mean, the checklist kind of thing. And that's, I love that narrative where you're not, even if you're half watching, not truly paying attention, you're still completely with what's going on in the story. And I find that kind of comforting. I don't know why, but as an audience, I don't want to try to like, you know, get confused or, you know, like Pulp Fiction. I mean, the first time you watch that, you're like, what, nonlinear? What's going on here? And I'm not knocking Tarantino. It's just like the first time you can't like follow all of it super
well
fast.
We were 15 when it came out, so like there is that element to it as well, right? Like yeah.
I think I saw this like I saw Pulp Fiction way after Payback. It was probably like freaking like
wow
20 okay. I bet it's 2006 or something, 2007. Oh, it was a while after. But yeah, Payback was one of those foundational ones. And as you were mentioning just some of those things, Julia, I was like, and I put that in my novel, and I put that into my novel, like all these little hints of Payback in there. And I'm like, wow, I took so much of my inspiration from Payback. I was like, let's just make Porter a cop. And that's my idea. Go. And I mean, it's way more complicated than that, but Yeah, I took some inspiration from that book and from the character, and I'm just laughing. As you mentioned, I'm like, yep, totally borrowed some of these things. And I'm okay with it though, because we're all borrowing from something else at some point. We can't act like everything's brand new. But yeah, it's just all those little writing creative choices that we make, and it's just really interesting and fascinating looking back to kind of say, wow, these little tweaks made such a different impact on the audience.
I mean, I think we should mention, just because like we alluded to it, but like since we talked about killing the dog as a problematic part of the director's cut, we should mention that one of the things that tested really poorly, or that they had qualms about, was the scene between Porter and his wife, where he comes back to visit her and they just have this knockdown, drag out fight.
Yeah.
Which is extremely intense.
It's crazy. Yeah.
I think they both perform it very well. And there's just like real layers and richness to the depths of the violence, and to, you know, like it's choreographed really well, and you can see that he's really angry at her for betraying him, and he's really angry at her for, you know, for falling into addiction and for doing that to herself, and there's all these different kinds of anger and love and pain and stuff just like wrapped up in that fight. But it is incredibly disturbing.
and that's probably why a big factor why I don't like the director's cut, frankly. And I mentioned it earlier, where that's where Deborah broke her rib. Like when she gets tossed into the oven, it's too much to stomach. It's too real looking. It's too, gritty and raw in a way I don't want to see. Whereas the theatrical, I mean, yeah, he swings open the door, kicks open the door. He doesn't know his wife is right there. I mean, he could maybe guess, but he doesn't know. And it's like, he's not like, you know, it's nothing like the director's cut. It's not even, it's, you know, what, 10 times worse in the director's cut. So I think that's a, you know, it's, and I'm sure that was a huge part of it as well. I mean, that and the dog, and then just the one of the deaths at the end. I think those were the three main parts why Brian was like, no, I want to keep this. And I'm sure Mel was a big part of it, but I'm sure the producers were like, look, we got to go. No, we're not having this person portrayed in that way. Yeah. And then you find out later that a lot of it, I mean, I don't know how much of it's true, but I mean, a lot of it's definitely very, very suspect and problematic at best. So
yeah, I will say one thing about that whole scene that I did kind of find like weirdly charming. That's not the word for it. Here's the thing, right? I as I'm watching them in the midst of that fight scene, the way the kitchen is the set decoration on the kitchen. Mm-hmm. Gives, and especially in the color version, because like you can really see what they've done, it's so comically a projection of like a person whose life is in disarray. Like nobody is messy in that specific way, where there's like these brown scuff marks all over the stove and all over the fridge that don't make any sense. There's like literally dishes like piled high. Like, when is she like baking? Like, what, like, you know, it doesn't, nothing about it is logical. And so I do think there's at least an attempt to, again, you referred to this movie as a fantasy, and I think there's an out, like that's not wrong. You know, noir has a misogyny like thread, right?
Sure.
That runs through it, and the way it's kind of, you know, telegraphing the surreality of the world here, right? And we talked about this with like the rotary phones and everything else, but it's so specifically, like, it looks like, you know, Sarah's mom's apartment in The Crow, getting back to The Crow. It's exactly what it reminded me of. I'm like, this is not like real. Like, this is not a real person's actually.
It's almost
like,
cliche to it. To yeah. Point. You're like, yeah, you're like, and this is a big trope.
Yeah. It's like comically cliche.
I think there's really, I mean, part of why I would like get on my like cinematography matters. Like it matters what you do with the movie. Hobby horses, like there's really beautiful, really thoughtful, surrealistic, as you would put it, production design in this movie. And it just like when it's not, you know, when it's not shown the way it was photographed, you know, when it's not, you know, lit and, you know, the palette is not how it's meant to be photographed. You don't, you know, pick up on all of that, you know, like.
Yeah, I find it kind of interesting. Maybe I'm totally geeking out, truly revealing my true colors here, but like this movie was filmed in a lot of the exact same places as The Dark Knight. Same exact places. Like when I went to Chicago about a year ago, I was like picking new locations for my novel and I was taking pictures like a total tourist. I was like, ooh, that's a nice shady back alley. And I was like, ooh, that's great. I'm going to put that in my book. Cause I'll use realistic things in my stories to, you know, make it more real. And like the big scene in The Dark Knight where the semi flips over is like right in front of the Board of Trade. And it's like blatantly in Payback. And that, I mean, stuff has changed since 99 and 98 when this was filmed, but a lot of it's the same. And I was like, I was riding the L train and I'm getting off at the same stops where Mel's getting in a shootout. And it was really cool just to kind of walk around and see, you know, 24 years later, 23 years later. Yeah, businesses have changed, but Chicago L trains are Chicago L trains. And by the Board of Trade, it still looks exactly the same for the most part. And
yeah,
it even like maybe that's somewhat in my head a little bit more where it's like, I can't get away from the whole anti-hero Batman kind of Payback. Like they're all very similar, they're all serious characters with massive issues, but I think at some point if I put it in my mind and say, okay, what they really want is justice, I can swallow it and enjoy the story and have fun with the ride. If I don't look at it through that lens, I'm going to be like, these are a bunch of crazy people just killing each other for no reason. And it was a lot of fun though, going around Chicago and just seeing all the sights. And, you know, I know it's a major city that's used a lot for film, but it's a huge part of this movie. The setting matters.
Yeah. And even though it's very specifically not like not any one city, right? It's never like said what the city is in the movie. You're right. Like it is Chicago and it's very clear.
Yeah. Yeah. More so when you have a shootout at the L stop.
Right. Yeah. Like at the L stop right there in the train practically. So.
Yeah, we'll have you pitch your book specifically to us in a few minutes. But I think that's a good place to kind of leave it and wrap up a little bit here. So we're gonna close with two questions. I know now that you have been looking through the list of 1999 movies, so you'll have a good answer at your disposal here when I ask you this question. Okay. Aside from Payback, what is your favorite movie of 1999?
I would say Fight Club. I would say Fight Club. Because
good back-to-back double feature there,
yeah, Fight Club. And I've actually interacted with Chuck a bit and I've learned a lot from that book, and I feel like that book was one that broke down a lot of walls for men reading, because it was like that the book and the movie are very much woven together in my mind. I haven't watched Fight Club in years. That's a hard watch. That's nothing like a nice short little 90 minute revenge movie. But I think Fight Club probably is my top one from 99. But it's amazing how many fantastic movies were 99. I mean, that was like 10 years of movies in 1 year. So
it's such an interesting thing that you said that like Fight Club got men reading.
I think it did. I really, and I know, Chuck said it too.
I think you're right. I knew many, many dudes of my age who read the book Fight Club were like not big readers and went through a bulimic phase and all that sort of thing. So that's a great point. Do you have a go-to answer for your favorite movie of all time?
I think The Godfather. Again, going back to anti-heroes, because it was so rich. It was Shakespeare with the mob. And like, I was thinking about it. I was like, what would my top three actually be? And I think The Godfather still is number one. There's so much in there that you can kind of shift focus and be like, and let's focus on Tom Hagen or let's focus on Sonny. And there's just so much in there. And the novel is really good. I wish that it was a little shorter and I wish some parts were not in there.
That's your note for everything.
I that is my answer. Shorter. Honestly, I want everything to be more minimalistic. I do. You should see me when I'm editing for a client. I'm like, that 300 page book, make it 200. Come on, get to the
yes,
good stuff.
Yes, you should. Get to the good stuff. Doing the Lord's work, my friend.
Thank you. You just made my month, maybe my year, because I just feel like attention spans are not getting better. Why are we trying to make stories more just in depth than they need to be? Be okay with the beginning, middle, and end, and let's move on.
I love it.
You know?
I should say that. I'm not saying that because like book should be shorter. But I do think, you know, like a lot of writers, myself very much included, which is why I said that, could use concision, help with
concision. I don't know anyone who doesn't like finishing a book. You know, it's like I finished versus I got halfway through and then it meandered. Guess what? If you get halfway through and then somebody puts it down, that's sad. I don't want that. You know, that's like, they don't care. They're not invested enough. And if you can kind of keep the stakes high and keep the action moving and the story moving, you're not going to hopefully have them put it down.
Yeah. Yeah. And look, let's also be clear. Like, there are 500 page books that absolutely need to be 500 pages.
Agreed.
Like,
yes.
That's, right.
Yes.
Like that's, but yes, you're absolutely right. There is a, the Matt Reeves Batman movie that I liked quite a bit is a good example of this.
You don't
want to
get me on that one.
This is an hour too long.
Thank
right?
you.
Like this.
Thank
like,
you.
We don't need a full hour. Like, I felt like I was there for several days.
Preach it,
watching
brother.
That movie. And I loved every minute of it, honestly, but like, it just was, it was too long.
I could get in a good podcast with you tearing that one apart.
Honestly, though, I think it's like, you know, get it down to a tight 90. I think it's a question, you know, all directors could ask themselves, you know, it's like, what would this be if we got it down to a tight 90?
I love it. And I've talked to a couple friends who are like that too, but most of them are dads who are watching at night and they're like you find yourself falling asleep and you don't know where you fell asleep.
Yeah.
Or you start a book and you never finish it. It's like, that's kind of feels like a waste of time. If you're like, I don't even know what happened. I just snoozed off.
Barry Sonnenfeld, he once said that a movie should be 90 minutes because that's a dream cycle. That's a REM cycle. So that's why 90 minutes is a perfect length for a movie.
I like it.
There's
like
not
it.
That many like 90 logic. Minute ones out there in existence, really.
There's more than you think. I mean, most of the movies that I've encountered lately, I feel have been sort of hugging the 90-minute mark. And like...
comedies?
Once they hit... and like some like the horror movies, you know,
shorter.
The more recent ones, that sort of thing. I don't, because I'm one said dad, and so like I don't really necessarily have more than 90 minutes, if that, at my disposal most of the time. But this is, I mean, we could have a whole more hour of this conversation.
I'm enjoying this. This is amazing, friends. I love it. I'm like, this is invigorating.
But we should cut to the chase. All right. So before we go, why don't you tell people about this novel that you keep alluding to and also like how to find you and interact with you on the internet?
Sure. My website for my fiction is authorjimwoods.net. I'm Jim Woods Writes on all other platforms. I love working with other writers, and I'm actually editing my third novel. I have a trilogy going right now. I literally have the proof and I'm marking it up. This one I'm working on right now is called Pull the Trigger with my three bullets here. Nice. And my first book is called Bite the Bullet, and it is a very gritty, very, you know, revenge focused Chicago cop really going to war with some cartels. And he's a dad, so he has a lot to lose. And Wire plus some Tarantino dialogue kind of approach, and then a healthy dose of Payback.
Cool.
With a kind of a vigilante cop who's on the edge, and really watching a good cop basically fall from grace is kind of the, you know, kind of the vibe. And it's like you can even almost pick up some hints of Godfather with cops. I'm a big fan of the anti-hero because I think they're more complicated and there's just so much more there.
Yeah.
And I think, you know, every hero has some serious flaws. That's why Superman isn't get the love he should, because he's not like flawed enough, in my humble opinion. That's why people don't migrate toward him as adults. They love him as kids, but most of us are Batman fans because, you know, we know Batman is seriously flawed.
Iron Man.
So, yeah. My cop is Ryan Malone. He's a raving alcoholic falling apart at the seams, but also wants to be a good dad and also wants to be a good cop. And it's like, you know, make your choices.
So if Lee Marvin is interested, will you take the call?
Is Lee Marvin still alive? I don't even think he is.
Very much
so. I don't think so.
All right. Jim, this is great. Thank you so much for reminding us this movie existed. I don't think Julia had ever seen it before.
No, I had not. It was really fun.
Wow. Oh, my gosh. Watch it about 50 times, then you'll learn to love it more.
I don't know about that, but it was great to be reminded of this, and yeah, what an interesting little nugget from this overwhelming year that we talk about on this podcast. So I really appreciate you reaching out, and it's been great having you. And sometime down the line, we'll have you back for something completely different. And I will. As soon as I have time to read a book, not for work again, I will look forward to reading your novel. It sounds really cool.
Well, thank you so much.
Right up my alley. So, you can, in the meantime, find us on the interwebs at 1999 The Podcast, on all of the social medias. You can email us at 1999@cageclub.me, and we'll be back next time to talk about Andy Kaufman and Man on the Moon. So thanks, Jim. Thanks, Julia.
Thanks so much,
Julia,
for having me.
Enjoy the rest of your time in Spain, in bathrooms and outside of bathrooms. I hope you have a good trip.
Try to get out of the bathroom.
hopefully the stuff outside the bathrooms is more interesting. And we will see you next time. Look out for frogs.
How lucky can one guy be? I kissed her and she kissed me. Like the fella once said, ain't that a kick in the head? The room was completely black. I hugged her and she hugged back. Like the sailor said, quote, ain't that a hole in a boat? My head keeps spinning. I go to sleep and keep